Father. Glory to God. How you guys doing? Amen, oh man. Day six. Get this jacket right. Day six, we're doing good. How you doing? You guys doing good? Doing good? Amen. Amen. Staying strong in the Lord. That's what it's all about in fasting time. Remember, anytime you feel like you want to go to whatever it is you're fasting on, you go to prayer. Prayer is the answer to every craving. Prayer is the answer to every desire. Whatever you're fasting for victory over, whenever you feel the thoughts of that activity trying to pull you back, that's when you go to prayer. You're teaching your flesh two things. You're teaching your flesh, one, that the spirit is in charge. That's the first thing you're teaching. That's what fasting and praying is all about. You're teaching your flesh that the spirit man is in charge. I don't care if you want to eat. We're not eating right now. I don't care if you, I want to think this thought. I want to go to social media. I need to use a phone. No, I'm fasting on whatever that is right now that's trying to control me. If I choose to do it, that's the spirit choosing to do it. But if my flesh is craving it, and then I give in to the flesh, that means we're listening to the flesh. When we choose to do something, the spirit man is choosing it. But when the flesh is calling you to do something and you answer the flesh, that means your spirit needs more strength, more fasting to put that, to reverse that, to keep the spirit under control. Amen. And that's the mindset. That's what our topic today is about. Our topic today is the mindset for battle. Because you got to look at this. Remember, we're trying to walk in victory. The last thing the devil wants is us to walk in victory. So this is a battle. See, people don't look at fasting and praying as a battle. But you're trying to overcome something here. You're trying to break a stronghold. You're trying to change something about yourself. The devil's trying to pull you down with something about yourself that you're trying to change. And whatever it is you're trying to change, the devil is trying to keep you from doing that. He's trying to keep you from walking in that victory. So that's what the battle is. The battle to achieve whatever it is we're fasting for during this particular month. And that's why we're trying to hold on to and get this thing right here. The camera in the right place here. So that's why we're, amen, Pinthia. That's what our mindset is. So when I'm saying our mindset for fasting is, for example, if you work a stressful job, and I told you this before as I get into the scriptures momentarily, when you're working a stressful job, the hardest thing to be in victory in a stressful job is if you pick a fasting that's really strict as far as eating, but you need energy at a stressful job. That's the wrong type of fast to pick at that time, because you need energy physically to make it through that job. Now you want to fast. Remember, fasting is a sacrifice. So even if you can't fast the way you want to fast as far as eating, but because you need energy at your job, as long as you're still fasting, and the fasting that you're choosing is a sacrifice, you feel that you're missing what you're fasting on. If it's television, if it's social media, if it's certain types of food, if it's sugar, if it's whatever it is, that you now miss it, because you know what? I miss that. My body's craving it. That's the battle. The body's craving it. The body is calling you. What happened to cigarettes? What happened to my drugs? What happened to alcohol? What happened to my social media? What happened to my phone? What happened to television? Whatever it is, it's stealing your joy, and the body is calling you. What happened to it? What happened to it? Spirit man says, because I'm in charge now. That's what happened to it. I'm in charge, and I'm telling you when we're going to do it, when I choose to do it, not when my flesh craves it and I give into it. That's basically the bottom line. When the flesh is craving something and you give into it, the flesh is ruling you. When you choose to do something, the spirit man is choosing to do it. That's what the control battle, that's the battle right there. Flesh and spirit, as we read in the Bible all the time, that's an ongoing battle going on. That's why we got to speak it every day. Be sure you, the one mindset is to speak why you're doing this. Why are you doing this? Thank you. And you speak it by thanking the Lord for the victory over it. Day six, Lord, thank you, Lord, for another victory over whatever it is. Thank you, Lord. Day seven, thank you, Lord, for another victory, another day of victory over. See, when you thank the Lord and confess it, thank you, Lord, for the victory over what you're fasting for, then you're renewing while you're doing this. At the same time, you're confessing the victory over it, and you're speaking it. At life and death in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. You're speaking the victory over what you're fasting for every day. You just don't write it down and say it one time and then wait 30 days and say it again. No, when you're fasting for something, you got to speak it every day. We'll call those things that be not as though they were. We know where we're 30 days from now, we know where we're going to be spiritually, and we know where we want to be physically. We want to have total control over our body, over whatever it is we put on that list, and we're going to have total control spiritually and feel stronger. Because if you're praying every day on top of what we do every day, any day and any time your body is craving something and your answer is prayer, you're going to be stronger. I guarantee you're going to be stronger 30 days from now, because you're teaching the body that whenever I feel fear, whenever I feel anxiety, whenever I feel worry, whenever I feel whatever it is, my answer is prayer. That's the battle right there. See, that's why I'm calling this a battle. The battle is always in our mind. That's why the book says, that's why the scripture says, that's why the saying says, the battlefield is in our mind. That's why we have to capture every stronghold, every doubt, every negative thought, every fear, every plant, any negative talk. We got to capture it as soon as it comes into our mind. So when we say no weapon formed against me shall prosper, and every tongue that what rises against me, I shall condemn. See, when something rises against you, it's trying to steal your joy. Whatever it is, whether it's a personality, it could be words, backstabbers, liars, unbelievers, all those are trying to come in and come against you. No weapon formed against me shall prosper unless I listen to it. See, that's what I said. And every tongue that rises against me trying to pull me out of my peace, I shall condemn it. I shall condemn it means the same thing as I rebuke it. It's not coming into my mind. I'm not accepting it. I'm rebuking it, wholeheartedly disagreeing. It is not coming into my presence. I'm not thinking about it. I'm not going to accept it. I'm not going to believe it or receive it. And that's what I shall condemn means. That way, and we know we got the power of God behind us when we condemn it, when we go against it. So that's why and that's not just flesh. That's in the spirit world as well, because that's why we need Jesus every day, because we can only fight what we see. But when we got Jesus out of the back, we got the whole armor of God, the authority that we walk around with, now we deal with things that are attacking us that we can't see. We can't see a spirit of depression. We can't see loneliness. We can't see negativity, but we can feel it, because our flesh feels the effect of the negativity that comes against us. That's why we hold on to the word of God, and we're speaking life through the word of God over whatever we're being attacked by, something we can't see. And that's why we feel the peace of God come over us, which means we've rebuked the devil, we've resisted the devil, and he flees. That's why we feel peace of mind when we spend time with God, because that peace with God is like a spiritual force field that the devil cannot come in. The secret place of the Most High. He who dwells what? In the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty, where the devil cannot go. The devil cannot come near the shadow of the Almighty. So if that's where we live, guess what? If that's where we live, devil can't touch this. Don't. Can't touch this. Thank you, Jesus. That's right. Go way, way, way by window, devil. I'm under the shadow of the Almighty. So you get nothing. You ain't getting nothing here. Because when I'm under the shadow of the Almighty, there is no fear. There is no anxiety. No negative thoughts. Because that's why our mind can be stayed on him. The reason our mind can be stayed on him is because if that's where we're abiding, that's where abiding means, that's where you go every day. That's where can I find Fitz? Oh, he's abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. You seen Fitz today? Oh yeah, he's over there under the shadow of the Almighty. that's what it should be. That's what we should be living every day, especially during this next month of holding on to what we're trying to do. Now, our text for today is 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Now, I use this text because even though we're talking about battlefield in the mind, this is the battle with Jehoshaphat. Of how they use fasting and praying in physical battle. But physical battle or spiritual battle are very similar. We have to do the same things because we are living in the flesh. Now, this scripture is talking about a physical battle that the Spirit of God moved on that gave them victory. And that's the same thing with us. Whatever we're putting on this list to walk in victory over, we are lifting up on the altar. We put it on the altar. We're praying every day. And now we're praying and fasting to the Lord to say, Lord, I need victory in this area. I need victory in this area. And when the Lord sees what you're going through, to have faith in him to give you victory in this area, that's like we talked about yesterday. When God saw the city of Nineveh turn away from their evil ways, put on the sackcloth, and go on a citywide fast, God spare the entire city, because that shows that God sees your heart. God sees your desire to turn away from your wicked ways, to change what is it about you that's ungodly, what is it about you that's killing his temple, what is it about you that you need to change for the betterment of your being closer to him in the way you behave, and any bad habits or anything, bad habits physically or spiritually. We're cleansing ourselves spiritually when we're fasting and praying. That's why we want to do those things. Amen. Now, let's start with verse 1. I'm actually going through 1 through 25. I'm going to kind of skip through it, but I want you to write down 2 Chronicles 20, 1 through 25. Now, what I'm going to do in comparing this physical battle, I'm going to be comparing the battle we're all dealing with in our fasting and praying month. Now, verse 1, that came about after the sons of Moab and the sons of Ammon came together with some of the Midianites, came to make war against Jehoshaphat. And some came and reported to Jehoshaphat, a great multitude is coming against you from the sea out of Aram, and behold, they are in Hazazon, and that is in Gedi. Now, stop right there. Verse 1 and 2 is the thing we're trying to overcome. Now, here is a major group of two different, the Moabs and the Ammonites. They're coming against the king. He sees all these people are coming to attack the city. Now, in connection with what we're going through in our fasting period, whatever we put on our list, consider that as what has been trying to keep us from being the best we can be. Whether it's eating, whether it's behaving, whether it's what we're putting in our bodies, that attack on our body, remember our temple, our body is our temple where the Holy Spirit lives. So our body's gonna be under attack automatically, because if that's where the Holy Spirit lives, the devil's gonna try to figure out, how can I keep a stress on this physical body? I gotta keep this physical body under stress because that's where the Holy Spirit lives. So even though he has no control over the Holy Spirit, that's what his thought process is. If he can get us to listen to the lies, the deceptions, distractions, haters, naysayers, church hurt, family hurt, all soul ties, all those attacks. This is verse 1 and 2 of chapter 20. Chapter 20, verse 1 and 2. I'm showing you the difference. Now, that's the attack of the enemy. Now, the attack of the enemy is what we put on our list. Continue. Verse 3 now. Jehoshaphat was afraid. And first thing he did, he's afraid. And turned his attention to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all Judah. So Judah gathered together to seek help from the Lord. They even came from all the cities of Judah to seek the Lord. Now, stop there. This is what we must be doing in our flesh. We got to seek the Lord whenever we feel any part of our body is under attack. We got to seek the Lord. We don't go to panic. We don't go to anxiety. We don't go to fear. We don't go into trying to figure out how we're going to do it. God's got this. That's why we're seeking the Lord. The reason we go to the Lord is to seek the help, to seek the deliverance, to seek the victory. We're not trying to figure out how we're going to beat this. You can't beat this. We need the Lord to beat this. Whatever it is we put in this list, that we're fast. The reason we're fasting and praying together is because we cannot beat this thing that we've got on our list by ourselves. But when we come together as a fellowship, praying for each other, and we're fasting and praying to be able to hold on, we're coming to the Lord, I need victory in this situation. I've been trying to break this habit. I've been trying to break this addiction. I've been trying to get this stronghold. I've been hurting, going through hurt and pain for 50, 30, 40 years, and I can't break it. We can't break it by ourselves. The Lord can break it. We can't. Nothing that's got a spiritual hold on us can we break in the flesh, because it's a spiritual battle. We can't win a spiritual battle in a fleshly body unless we got the power of the name of Jesus. That's our connection. That's our divine connection. The power in the name of Jesus gives us the spiritual tools to be able to walk in victory spiritually. Physically, without the Lord, we cannot win any spiritual battle, any physical, any spiritual attack. Without the Lord, we can't win that, because we'll panic. I don't know what I'm going through. And that's why we have to always make sure. We have to make sure we always hold on and never let go. And that again. Again, now let's look at verse 4. Now, 3 and 4 is the whatever the fear, turn to the Lord. Now, we're coming together. We're like all the people coming together. Now, verse 4, the seed of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Now, that's what we're doing as a fellowship. We're coming together corporately as a fellowship to fast and pray over all the various things we need victory over. Now, they know their enemy is one common enemy. In the Bible right here, their enemy are these two sects of people coming to attack the city. We as a fellowship all have individual attacks that we want to overcome, but as a fellowship, we're coming together to seek the Lord together for 30 days, praying for each other, lifting each other in prayer. And when we see each other's prayer requests and desires written under lesson 594, we can actually look at that in archives and pray for each other to be victorious over what we're listing. Sometimes you may see a fellow fellowship member going through the same thing you're going through. They may have the same thing on their list, and that gives you another bond to say someone else is going through the same thing. Someone else is trying to fight this battle, the same battle I'm trying to find. And see, that's where two or more are coming together to pray together. Now they came to seek the Lord. Now let's continue. Jump down. Verse five. Then Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of the Judah and Jerusalem and the court and the house of the Lord and before the new court. And he said, O Lord God, our Father, are you not God in heaven? Are you not the ruler over all the kings and rulers of the nation? Power and might are in your hand so that no one can stand against you. Did you not, O our God, drive out the inhabitants of the land before your people, your Israel, and you give it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend forever? Now, stop right there. What are they doing? They're praising God. So they're fasting and praying. What do we do every day? What do we do every day before we get to this point? We do about 35 minutes to 40 minutes of praise and worship, praising our way through whatever we come on. Some of us may come on with a heavy heart, but we're praising, because even though we know we're going to lay on the altar, you may feel terrible when you first come online. But when you start praising, something about praise is infectious. When you praise God, even when you feel down, by the end of that praise, if you really did praise through it, when I say praise through it, that means even if you feel depressed, you feel like you're going through heaviness, you praise God anyhow. And the act of praising God anyhow is slapping the devil upside the head, because he doesn't want you to praise. He's trying to steal your praise. He's trying to steal your joy. So even if you don't feel like praising and you still praise God anyway, you got the nerve to still move your head. You got the nerve to still tap your foot. Maybe you might not even have the strength to say hallelujah, but you're still praising. Your head's bobbing. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Whatever it is, but you're still pushing. You're still pressing through the heaviness. And usually by the end of that time, that's why I praise for 35 to 40 minutes, because I know some of us come on with heaviness in our heart. We're being attacked all kinds of ways on the fellowship. So when we start out 35, 40 minutes of praise, we're telling the devil, I know you hit me right now. I know you're trying to knock me off my feet, but guess what? I'm still praising in your face. That's why we keep praising. We keep praising because he knows he's trying to hit us. He's trying to knock us. He's trying to knock that Holy Ghost smile off our face. Guess what, devil? You'll never knock the smile off my face because I got the joy of the Lord. Yeah, you're going to knock me down. But guess what? I'm going to be praising on my back. You may be knocking me off my feet, but guess what? I'll be laying on the ground praising. So if you're trying to steal my praise, you might as well go way, way, way from this window, because you're not going to steal the praise. No matter what you're doing, you're not going to steal our praise. We're going to say praise God anyhow. No matter what we're going through, no matter what we're going through, keep on praising, because praise is what we do, and praise will praise your way through whatever you're going through. Amen. Amen. So that's what they're doing. So right there in those two verses, get back here. So verse 6 and 7, they're praising God. Look at verse 8. Now they still, the last part, they still praise. Last verse 8 is continued. They're still praising. They have lived in it and had built your sanctuary. There are your name saying, should evil come among us, the Lord, the judgment, or pestilence, or famine, we stand before his house, this house, and before you, and cry to you in our distresses, and you will hear us and deliver us. Now, in the midst of that verse right there, those two verses, first they start with praise, like we always do, praise. And then they start remembering the victories of God. What are we doing when we say, you saved me? You saved me. We start out praising God, thank you for your goodness and mercy. Praise God for your goodness and mercy. And then we go to you save me, which is thanking God for all the times you moved. Thanking God for all the things you've done in the past. Because if he did in the past, he's going to do it again. So that's why we That's why we do the order that we do in the fellowship. We're following the divine order of spiritual warfare. You start out praising. You thank the Lord for all he's done, period. You recognize his goodness and his grace and his mercy and his life. And then you start remembering all the things he's done for you, because, and you let him know, I'm coming to you, Lord, because I've got this situation. Now, notice all the way up now, what it said in verse 2. Jehoshaphat heard the bad news in verse 2. But up to verse 8, he still has not mentioned the problem. So he's hit by the problem, and the first thing he does is what? Go to the Lord. Now, he didn't panic. As soon as he heard, you got all these people coming to attack you. He didn't go, well, man, do I have enough men? What are you gonna do? No, man, king, all these people are coming to attack the kingdom. I gotta take it to the Lord. See, what did he do? Have no fear, stand still. What did he just do? All these thousands of soldiers are coming to attack the kingdom, and he doesn't panic. He goes to the Lord and then declares a fast. Now, see, that's something that doesn't make sense to people in the world. People say, why are you praying? You need to do something. I am doing something. I'm praying. Nothing I can do in this flesh. If I got a problem bigger than me, nothing I can do in this flesh is going to give me victory. If I know I need the Lord, the first thing I'm going to do is pray, because I don't know how I'm going to do it. I don't know how I'm going to make it through it, because I need the Lord, because the Lord sees ahead of me. Lord sees the big picture. I only see two blocks down the road. I'm going through some struggles right now. I have no idea how I'm going to make it through it, but I know the Lord sees down the road. The Lord sees the whole city. So if I say, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. I don't know. I'm going through some stuff. I'm going through some times right now, Lord. I don't know where to go. So I'm coming to you. I don't know where to go, so I'm going to the one who can see the whole city. I can only see the block down the street, but God can see the entire city. He knows exactly how to take us whatever route we need to go to get to where we need to get to be victorious. That's the main thing. That's why we come to the Lord. That's why we come to the Lord. We cannot do this by ourselves, because our flesh cannot see everything that God can see. That's why what? His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts higher than our thoughts. That's why we trust him, because we know his ways are higher than our ways, and he can see way more than we can see. We're in this limited flesh, and we're talking to an unlimited God in seeing and doing. Amen. Now still, he hasn't mentioned the problem yet. So at first he went to the Lord, fast and prayed. Then he started praising. Then he started remembering all the goodness of the Lord, and still hasn't mentioned the problem. So see, that's the importance of when you're hit by something, don't go out of order. If you're hit by something heavy, don't just go, Lord, I need you. No, oh, Father God, I need you right now. Lord God, Almighty God, praise your name, Father God. You're going to praise first, because just by praising God first slaps the devil, because he wants you to go into depression first. But as soon as you're hit by something heavy, don't go into heaviness. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I need you right now, Lord. I got just hit by some bad news. I got some fear. I got some bad news. I've got some anxiety, Lord. I need you right now. And see what you're doing? You got hit by the bad news like he did in 1 and 2, but you go into the prayer time with the Lord. And if it's something really big that you need to fast and pray for, then you're not just going to go to the Lord in prayer. You go into the Lord fasting and praying, because, you know, Lord, I'm going to need some serious prayer here. I need to fast and pray. This, like Jesus told the disciples, some things cannot be done with just prayer. Some things can only be moved by fasting and prayer, which means, though, I'm taking to not just taking to the Lord in prayer. I'm taking to the Lord and giving it all on the altar, and I'm fasting for it. I'm showing the Lord, I need you to move in this situation, Lord. I'm laying this thing down on the altar right now, Lord, and I'm fasting and praying for it. I'm fasting and praying for it. That's what we're doing. Now, look at verse 10. Now behold, the sons of Ammon and Moab and the Mount Seir, whom you did not let Israel invade when they came out of, and they're still remembering here, Israel came out of the land of Egypt. They turned aside from them and did not destroy them. See how they are rewarding us by coming to drive us out. Now he's talking about the problem. The people that were on our side, now they're rewarding us by coming to drive us out from your possessions, which you have given us. Oh God, will you not judge them? For we are powerless before this great multitude who are coming against us, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Whoa, hold up. Nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are on you. That's right there. That's the sermon right there. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Overwhelmed by a powerful multitude. Verse 12, our God, will you not judge them? For we are powerless before this great multitude who are coming against us, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are on you. What does that say? Keep in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you. See, that's where the key of our strength is. Keeping our mind stayed on the Lord is where our strength is. You get weak when you go into panic, because when you go into panic and worry and fear and struggle and trying to figure out how you're going to do it, you don't hear a thing the Holy Spirit is telling you, because fear, as I always say, fear makes spiritual noise. If you're in a spirit of fear, anxiety, Holy Spirit is trying to tell you what to do. First, the Holy Spirit might be trying to tell you, calm down, take a deep breath, go into God's presence and stand still, and I will give you the directions of what you need to do. But you can't hear that if you're in fear, if you're in anxiety, a stress attack, panic attack. That means you're looking at the world, you're looking at the problem first and not looking at God first. We got to look at God first in order to hear the Holy Spirit tell us what we need to do to walk in victory over the thing that's attacking us. If we go into panic first, we can't hear the Holy Spirit, because our flesh is trying to do what the Lord is trying to do. Amen. No scripture, he hit to finish. Amen. So that's why we have to make sure that we always hold on to that. Now let's continue. We're now after they finished that part, let's look down to verse 13. All Judah was standing before the Lord with their hands and their wives and their children. Verse 14. Then in the midst of the assembly, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, and the son of Benaiah, and the son of Jeel, the son of Mattaniah, and the Levite sons of Aspha. And then he said, listen, all Judah, all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord, do not fear or be dismayed because of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours. What do you say? The battle is not yours, but God's. Isaiah 14:13. The Lord will fight for you. Hold your peace. Again, here it comes again. Do not be dismayed because of this great multitude. Now, in our case, do not be afraid because of what this is we're trying to overcome. Do not be afraid of what this is. The battle is not yours. See, when we try to address it in the flesh, we're making the battle ours. When we take it out of God's hands, we're trying to figure out how we're going to do it. We've just taken it out of God's hands, and we're trying to do God's job of be victorious. We cannot be victorious over something bigger than us without God. That's why we take it to the Lord. And now when we give it to the Lord, which is what he wants us to do, we give it to the Lord. That's something easy for the Lord. Oh, you need me? Oh, no. Done. See, God deals with it with a snap of the fingers. We can't deal with it. We can stress out, have anxiety attacks, heart attacks, all kind of panic attacks, and the problem's not going anywhere. We give it to the Lord, done. Oh, I should have come here before. I should have taken it to the Lord before. Yeah, you think? All right, now. So now, in this case now, this is a man of God that was anointed. This is a person who is amongst the people who are fasting and praying the Lord gave a word to. See, God can validate what you need to hear either through me in the fellowship, or it might be a friend of yours that comes up who's into the word, and they just say something to you that validates something you're praying for, and they have no idea you're praying for it. They just say, you know what? The Lord told me today that you need this, blah, 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 blah. And you go, wow, how'd you know I was praying for that? And that's validation. See, that's validation. The Holy Spirit always validates. When you get a word spoken to you, the word itself is not new, because usually the Holy Spirit tells you something already, and you're wondering, should I move on this? Should I move on this? And then someone that you may not even know walks up and says, you know, you should think about this. And it's exactly what you're praying for. That's validation. And that's where the Holy Spirit works. You'll get the word first, and then someone will come along and say something that is exactly the validation of what you were wondering if you need to move on. In this case, the word for them is, have no fear. The battle's not yours. Now, when you get the word from the Lord, next one, you must believe the word. Now, he just said battle's not yours. Next thing, tomorrow, verse 16, tomorrow go down against them. Behold, they will come up by the ascent of Ziz and you will find them at the end of the valley in front of the wilderness. But look at this, verse 17. You need not fight in this battle. Wait a minute. I'm going to war. What do you mean I'm not going to fight in this battle? Now here comes the flesh. Lean not to your own understanding. Lean not to your own understanding. What did it say? The battle is not yours, but God's. And then here comes, go down. Now, the validation of what he just said, the battle's not yours, but God's. And then tomorrow, you go down where they're going to be, but you need not fight in this battle. Station yourselves. Stand and see the salvation of the Lord. Wait a minute. What about fighting? No, he didn't say fight. He said stand and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. See, the battle's not yours, but God's. Stand what? Ephesians 6:10, stand firm against all the wiles of the devil. Continue. See the salvation of the Lord on your behalf, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not fear again. Do not fear or be dismayed. Tomorrow, go out to face them, for the Lord is with you. Now, go back. Hold up. Now, even though I did a lesson on this earlier, a Bible study on this at Home with the Word, the Lord told me to bring this back to us because everything I'm reading to you, I'm reading this lesson to you again today because I'm associating this lesson with what our battle is this month and what we're fasting and praying for victory over. Because remember, what we're trying to accomplish this 30-day fast is something that we cannot do alone. We need the Lord in fasting and praying to help us make it to this breakthrough we're trying to go through this entire month. And that's our battle. But notice, again, the battle's not ours. When we're fasting and praying, we're giving the battle, we're giving the things we wrote down on the list to the Lord, and we're praying for victory over it every single day. We're praying for it every single day. We're speaking it every day. We're withholding the flesh, calling out, saying, come back. Where'd you go? I need this. I need that. No, you're not. I'm praying right now. Don't bother me, flesh. Get thee behind me, flesh. I'm praying right now. Excuse me. See, that's what we're saying every single day. Now go on, verse 18. Jehoshaphat bowed his head and his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants fell down before the Lord, worshiping. Now, once they just understood the battle's not theirs, you will not need to fight, they went back into prayer. Because now think about this. You're about to go into a fight with thousands of people, and the word of God said, you will not need to fight. Just go there, stand there, and watch God. Now, here comes the flesh. Lean not to your own understanding. But see, the biggest mistake we make in the flesh, but God, how are we going to do that? Duh, wrong. Never ask God how we're going to do that, because now you're doubting God. God just said, stand still and just stand firm. What? Stand firm and see the salvation. Just like in the part in the Red Sea, have no fear. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Stand still and watch God work. We have the most problem in our flesh. When it's time to stand still, we get impatient, we start worrying, we start wondering how God's going to do it. And once you stop taking your eyes off God and try to figure out how he's going to do it, the devil comes in. Well, I don't know how he's going to do it. You know, matter of fact, he's not going to do it. See, the devil will wait for you to take your eyes off the Lord to whisper lies while you're trying to hold on. While you're trying to hold on to your faith and you take your eyes off God, here comes the devil. Oh, God's not going to do that. You pray for that, God's not going to hear you. Your prayer's not working. Get thee behind me, Satan. Go way my window. Excuse me. I keep my eyes stayed on the Lord, who's my deliverer. Amen. That's why they fell down to worship. Now, let's go skip down to verse 20. They arose in the morning and went out to the wilderness. And then when they stood out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to what happens in Jerusalem. Look at this. Put your trust in the Lord your God, and you will be established. Put your trust in his prophets and succeed. Right there. That's our challenge. Not just this fast. That's our challenge in life. Put your trust in his prophets and succeed. Trust the Lord your God, and you will be established. Now, verse 21. When he consulted with the people, he appointed those who sang to the Lord and those who praised him in the holy attire as they went out before the army. Wait a minute. He didn't send the army out first. He sent praisers out first. Now, in real life, you're going, wait a minute. I'm not sending the soldiers first. You're sending people to praise God in front of the soldiers. But remember, the word said, you will not need to fight this battle. See, if you need not to fight this battle, that means I'm going to be praising God the whole time, because I don't know how he's going to do it. I'm just going to keep praising God. So he picked a group of praisers to go before the army. Verse 22, when they began singing and praising God, whoa, listen to this. When they began singing and praising, the Lord, who did it? The Lord. The Lord set ambushes against the sons of Ammon, the other tribes who had come against Judah, so they were routed. For the sons of Ammon and Moab rose up against each other, destroying them completely. And when they had finished the inhabitants, they helped to destroy each other. So the two different tribes coming together to attack. First, God turned the tribes on each other, and then he turned the tribes on themselves. Verse 22, when Judah came to look out over the wilderness, they looked out toward the multitude, and behold, there were corpses lying on the ground, and no one had escaped. When Jehoshaphat came to take their spoil, they found much among them, including goods and garments and valuables, things they could take for themselves, more than they could carry. It took 3 days to get the things and spoils that all those soldiers bought that they could use at their own, for their own tribe. Now, the biggest thing you need to understand, when they started praising, what started happening? That God is moving in praise. They started praising. That's when God started turning the enemy against himself. The enemy that was attacking us, the enemy that was attacking them, they started praising, and instead of attacking them, the enemy started turning themselves on each other. So there was no battle. Go back to verse 20. The battle is not yours, but God's. That's why we praise. That's why I spend so much time every day of at least 30 minutes of praise. Worship Wednesday, almost an hour, because praise is moving things in the spirit. That's why we are praising God, to move in the situation of whatever we cannot do by ourselves. We're praising for the victory. We're praising for the healing. We're praising for deliverance. We're praising for the chains of bondage to be broken. That's what this whole lesson is about. Now, when I first did this lesson, I was just talking about prayer. But now I'm trying to let you understand the order again. This is a review of what I did the first time. This lesson right here, I'll give you many other scriptures in the lesson under the video. But this lesson right here is showing the battle that was theirs, the battle that we're putting on our list of what we're praying for this month and fasting and praying for, our battle is against that thing that we wrote down. That thing that we wrote down is what we're fighting against, that we cannot gain victory on by ourselves. And that's why we're fasting and praying, to gain the victory over that. And while we're fasting and praying, we're not just praying for our victory, but now that we're praying more, we're praying for others, we're praying for the nation, we're praying for loved ones, we're praying for however the Holy Spirit tells us to pray, because we got time now. We're spending more time with the Lord when you're fasting and praying. If you fast and pray and you spend less time praying, something's wrong, because you should be, whatever you're fasting on, whether it's television, food, social media, that gives you more time. And that extra time is not meant to play around with. That extra time is to give more prayer time, because you want to walk in victory in 30 days. We're trying to walk in victory. We want by February 4th, we all want to be shouting. I'm going to be doing a super long version of I'm Blessed, because by February 4th, we should all be marching and shouting and screaming, because we overcame whatever we put on our list this month to walk in victory over the rest of our life. Not just this month, whatever we get the victory over, that's going to be victory over it for the rest of our life. What did the word say? The struggle you see today, the enemy, the Egyptians you see today, the Egyptians, you will see no more forever. Not just no more, but no more forever. Think about what you're going through right now. Picture what you're fighting against. Can you imagine not just not having it no more, but no more forever? For the rest of your life, will you be dealing with this situation? Whatever it is whatever you're fasting, praying for right now, it will not be in your presence no more forever. For the rest of your life, you will have to deal with it. That's why it's so serious. We got to make sure we pray every day, steadfast and never let go, because we know we want to break through. We know what we're praying for, and now we're fasting and praying for it. We're giving up to the Lord. We're giving it to the Lord and say, Lord, I need this victory over this situation. I need your hand to move in this situation, Lord. I need your victory. I need your assistance, Lord. I cannot do this alone. And that's like Jehoshaphat. That's why they fell to the ground, because they we cannot do this. Lord, what did he say? What did he say? Go back. That's what it is. You will not need to fight this battle. You will not need to fight this battle. We're fasting and praying, but we don't need to fight this battle. All we need to do is keep praying. Keep praying, because by fasting and praying, we're showing the Lord how serious we are about this situation we want to gain victory over. And we're fasting and praying for the victory over it. So that what? You will not need to fight this battle. Stand and stand. What? Stand. Keep fasting. Keep praying. Stand and see the salvation of the Lord on your behalf. Do not fear or be dismayed. Tomorrow, go out and face them, and the Lord is with you. So every day we wake up, thank you, Jesus, for victory over this struggle. Thank you for victory over this, whatever I'm praying for. Thank you, Jesus. Every morning I wake up, just right after I say thank you, Lord, for another day, right behind that is thank you, Lord, for the victory over what I'm praying for. Because right now, praise. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name, Father God. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name, Father God, for touching the fellowship right now, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for just touching everyone in this fellowship, Lord, for all the areas of what you're going through, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for moving mightily in our situations, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, Father God. We just praise your name, Lord. We praise your name, Lord. Mightily, Lord. We praise your name, Lord. We give it all to you, Lord. Just as this song said, do you hear him calling your name? This song right here, do you hear him calling your name? Say, trust me. He's saying, trust me. Trust me. I got this. I got this. We don't need to worry about it. We don't need to worry about it. We give it to the Lord. We let it go and just say thank you. And we hold on to his hand every day. We thank him every day. We praise every day. We give it up to the Lord every day. We speak it every day. As a man thinks, so he is. Life and death and the power of the tongue. Those who love it will eat of his fruit, eat victory, eat healing, eat deliverance. Chains are breaking. Break the chains, Lord. We speak the victory right now. We speak victory right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Give it up to him right now. Give it up to him right now. Do you hear him calling your name? Do you hear him calling your name? Because he wants to give you the victory. He wants to give you the victory. But we got to give it up to him. We got to let go. We got to give it to the Lord, because he cannot give it to us if we don't let it go. We got to let it go. We got to let it go. We got to let it go. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name, Father God. It's the Lord. Woo!